Today, distinguished lecturer, and it's going to be a very interesting presentation, I can assure you. The distinguished lecture program is an annual event held here in Australia, being Region 7 of AIAA, and it's a program that's very interesting and very valuable to us because it gives us access to expert scientists and engineers and managers from the U.S. who are willing to spend some of their time down here giving lectures in a week's time, like it's a blitz tour, really. But we're fortunate that we're kicking off here in Melbourne, Randii. I also like to thank the Royal Aeronautical Society Melbourne branch and the Space Association for supporting this lecture tonight. So before I introduce the speaker, can I please ask you to switch off your mobile phones and please no flash photography. Thank you very much. So Dr. Randii Wessen, I'd like to introduce, received his bachelor's degree of science of ghost physics and astronomy from Stony Brook University and a master of science in astronautics from the University of Southern California. And a doctorate in operations research from the University of South Wales, which is the United Kingdom. So,
yes.
Yeah. He co-authored a couple of books. One of them is Neptune, the planet rings and satellites, and planetary rings system. He was the recipient of NASA's Exceptional Service Medal for his contributions to the Voyager 2 Neptune encounter and has 11 NASA Group Achievement Awards. Dr. Wessen is also a fellow of both the Royal Astronomical Society and the British Interplanetary Society and an associate fellow of the American Institute of Aeronautics and Astronautics. And, the last sentence is, that's probably very honorable, asteroid 31664 is named after him. And he told me it's... And I just quickly asked him the question a few hours ago, is there any chance of a collision? He assured me it's not, so he's quite safe to name it after him. So his main role at JPL is A-team lead study architect for JPL's innovative foundries, and some of the work he's involved in, you'll see some of that tonight, is absolutely groundbreaking, very future, forward-looking activities that we probably all dream about to be involved in, but Dr. Wessen is actually doing it, so I better hand over to him for his lecture tonight. Randii, over to you.
Do tonight is, I'm not trying to get you guys to memorize everything NASA is doing, but there's a lot of stuff going on, so what I've tried to organize the talk is I'm going to first start with a little bit of history of where JPL came from, because not too many people realize where we came from and how we fit in with NASA, and then basically I'm going to drag you through the solar system. I'm going to start at Earth, and then Mars, then solar system, and then out into the universe. I'm only going to be good to about 30, 40 years into the future, because when you get further than that, it gets to be really science fiction, so even I don't believe that stuff. What I've done with the talk is it's almost exclusively pictures and movies, so I'm going to make the room dark because I want you to just really just enjoy just how spectacular the universe is. Come on in! The first thing, just to give you an idea of the context, NASA is broken up into 10 field centers. And each one has their own responsibility. So say you want to do, entry bodies and supercomputing. You work up in San Francisco at the Ames Research Center. And say you want to do, what's a fun one that you do? You'll do, airplanes. You work at Langley. And say you over there, you like to blow things up. You just think it'd be really cool. You know, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1. You'd work at the Kennedy Space Center in Florida. And say you want to be an astronaut. We put you at the Johnson Space Center in Texas. And I got one more, how about you back there? Say you want to visit every planet in the solar system. Problem is we're not smart enough to do that. So you'd work at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory. Where we do deep space robotic exploration, where we send our ambassador out into the world. So with that, I'm gonna make it dark. And I'm going to drag it to the solar system. So it's in place. And do that. And then start. The way the Jet Propulsion Laboratory started was back in the 1930s at a place called the California Institute of Technology. It's in Pasadena, California. And these guys in the 30s were doing rocket tests. They were dealing with things like red fuming nitric acid and other things that just explode on contact. And the administration was deathly afraid that they were going to really kill somebody. So the joke we say is, you can't tell faculty members what to do, but you can tell them where to go. They said, look, go 5 miles up into Arroyo and do your rocket testing there. The first group was indeed called the Suicide Squad. And these guys, pin helmets and all, were just doing rocket tests up there in the Arroyo. Well, one of the things that we were working on was how to get airplanes to take off faster, and that was by putting rocket bottles under the wings of airplanes so they could take off on half a runway. That means bad guys would need two bombs to destroy your runway. And when we signed the contract, the military, the Army, wanted to know what we called. We should have been called the Rocket Propulsion Laboratory, but we thought that was too much like Buck Rogers. So we said, okay, we're going to become the Jet Propulsion Laboratory Division of Caltech. So we became JPL in 1944. We were basically a division of Caltech, so we really were academic the way we started. Well, if you look at where we started, this is what JPL looked like in the early 40s. 177 acres, and I guess that's a barbaric term out here on this side, but this is 1942, and we just have barracks. Well, in 1958, NASA was created. NASA wanted JPL, but Caltech didn't want to give it up. So the deal that was worked was that NASA pays Caltech to run JPL. So that's the legacy. We're the other 9 NASA centers that are civil service. We at the Jet Propulsion Laboratory are all considered Caltech employees. Now, the first thing we did in 1958, and this is so cool, this is a great picture. The guy on your left is Bill Pickering, who's the director of JPL at the time. The guy on the right is Wernher von Braun, that did everything from the Redstones all the way to the Saturn V. The guy in the middle is Jimmy, and they're holding up Explorer 1. Jimmy was a professor at the University of Iowa, and we had called him up and said, hey, we have a little bit of room in the nose. If you could put any instrument in a spacecraft, what would you put in there? He said, I'd put a Geiger tube in there. That's Jimmy Van Allen of the Van Allen Radiation Belts. You've got Pickering, Van Allen, von Braun making the first scientific discovery in space. So that's our roots. This is JPL today. So it's a massive facility. We have about 5,600 employees there, an operating budget in US dollars around $1.5 billion. And we're just designed to just do things that no one's ever done in space. That's our call. Well, in order to talk spacecraft, you have to do this. These are the deep space networks. There's one out here in Canberra, near Tippendilla. These are how we communicate with deep space. And just to give you an idea how sensitive these things are, my first love is Voyager. That was my first spacecraft. Voyager, when it was out at Neptune, it has a high-power transmitter that transmits with 23 watts of power. That's the power it takes to run the light bulb in your refrigerator. If you now take this refrigerator and put it, let's see, 3.5, almost 5 billion kilometers out, the signal strength this thing has to pick up is roughly 1 billionth of 1 billionth of 1 watt. And now we're like 4 times further out. So these things really are impressive devices. Well, in order to leave the Earth, you've got to start somewhere. Let's start here. This is actual footage of a camera that's on the Delta II rocket where the green and the white interface is. And you're looking down at the solid rocket boosters there. That's the actual footage. Nothing is sped up, nothing is slowed down. This is the actual time it takes to get to space. And the thing that's difficult about it is it has to work the first time every time, and you can't have redundant components because that just adds more weight. So you can see the shadow of the exhaust on Florida as we're leaving. Here comes the Florida coast. And the trick is we're trying to make the price per pound to orbit cheap. In the Saturn 5 days, it was $1 million per pound. With the shuttle era, it was about $100,000 per pound. Today it's about $10,000 per pound, and Elon Musk of SpaceX is starting at $5,000 per pound, and he's trying to get it down to $100 a pound. So we are rapidly going to be a spacefaring planet. Now what I want to show you is when these boosters run out, we get rid of the solid rocket boosters, We just eject them and they burn up. Come on, you can do it. Come on, there you go. And when I want you to look in the upper left-hand corner, when that goes black, you're in space. And you can tell it just doesn't take long to do it. It just has to work the first time every time. And we are just about up. Come on. There we go. We're up. So it doesn't take long. But the challenge is you got to do successfully every time. So let's get that thing going. So in this picture, what you've got is a cartoon of the Earth with just a few of our Earth-observing spacecraft that are designed just to measure the Earth. So we can get a data set of how the Earth is behaving. Because before you can make any statement about the Earth, you've got to see how it works. So here, we take radar light. This is over the west coast by California. Los Angeles is that hump there. What we'll do is we'll take radar and we'll illuminate the ground. And then after a quake, we'll illuminate it again and make an interference pattern in it. So everything of the same color is the same amount of ground displacement. So we are teaching ourselves how the ground moves before and after an earthquake. And after you get good at doing that, maybe you can use that to predict future earthquakes. That's land. We also do stuff with the atmosphere.
Hi, this is Bill Putman. I'm a climate scientist at NASA's Goddard Space Flight Center. What you're looking at is a supercomputer model of carbon dioxide levels in the
Earth's atmosphere. Yes, that's what I was going to say. But basically, it's
visualization compresses 1 year of data into a few minutes.
My sound is not pressing. Okay, I'm going to go past that right now. My only political statement in this whole talk is this one. When we talk about carbon dioxide in the atmosphere, we talk about parts per million. When people tell you it's cyclical, yes, it is. It's about a 50,000 year cycle. The question you have to ask yourself after the 1950s is more than doubled. So the question you have to ask yourself, why did it do that? And were humans the cause of it? Now, I can tell you events I think happened after 1950 that would cause it. But if you're going to be rational and understand what's going on with the planet, you have to come up with a reason of why that's doing that. So when people say cyclical, yeah, sure. Why is it twice the magnitude? And it doesn't look like it's slowing down. So to do that, we have a number of spacecraft. And one of the things we do is, spacecraft, when we first build them, we give them a functional name. So it's like you would call you a male locomotive water bubble. This is SMAP, soil moisture, active passive. This thing has a radar that's active, so we hit the reflector and hits the ground and comes back. And then we have a passive radiometer. And what we're really doing is we're trying to see how water is frozen in the ground and how it melts. Because that's the last place water is hiding, is to understand how the system works. Now, one of the things that we're doing with Earth is the moon system, we're developing new mobility systems. So this one is called ATLEE, All-Terrain Hex-Limb Extraterrestrial Explorer. This is sped up by about a couple hours, but this was an idea of, this would be a half-scale Altera lander with a habitat module on it, and we built this structure to drive up to it, split in half, what we call a triathlete, grab the pallet, and then pull it off. Now, right now, we have to tell it each joint how to move. You know, move leg 3, shoulder joint, 27.5 degrees. Move elbow joint. So this whole sequence here takes about 2 hours. But what we're trying to do is teach it higher level capabilities so that we can actually drive these things around in a much more efficient manner. Because if you land on a surface like the moon and you just put your habitat modules there, that's colonization. So you put it on a mobile system where you can drive around, where you can either walk or drive, that's exploration. And this is a way to get a lot of the world to help out because you can bring supplies in different parts of the moon and keep driving to them. Now, if we leave the Earth and go to Mars, Mars has always been very schizophrenic. First they thought it was alive, then they thought it was dead. Then they thought it was live, then they thought it was dead. And there's reasons why. If you look at Mars, these are to scale. So Mars is about half the size of Earth. The three main features are you have Valles Marineris, which is a Grand Canyon that would stretch across Australia, coast to coast. You've got three shield volcanoes, those brown spots that you can see. Those are about the size of Mount Everest, The really big one you can see is about three times the size of Everest. It would probably take up a third of your continent, its footprint. So it was a huge volcano. But when we look at it, we see this. We see channels that look like some fluid was flowing on the surface to cut these things, and this is indicative of an old age channel. We've got polar caps that have dry ice and water ice in them. And your eyes are not deceiving you. This is actually looking up from the surface of Mars where you can see water vapor clouds. It's still very dry, but there really is H2O. There is water everywhere in this place. You look at the place where we land. Here's a map of Mars. The black line's the equator. You can see where everybody landed. We've got the three shield volcanoes here, and Olympus Mons is the white dot to the left. You can see where Curiosity is. When they did this, they made an altimeter map of it. Yellow was this reference level. When you go from reds to white, you're going high up. And when you go to greens and blues, you're going low down. The thing that was wild that blew the scientists away is when you look in the southern hemisphere, besides the house crater, you can see that the whole southern hemisphere predominantly is orange and red with a lot of cratering. So that's high up. So it's like a high plateau, and it's really old, because the number of crater impacts tell you something about age. If you look in the northern hemisphere, it's blue, which means it's low down. And though there are some craters, there aren't that many. That tells you that either something erased the craters there, or that something protected it. And the reason why the science community made these colors for this screening map was because they believe that Mars, 3 billion years ago, had a North Polar Sea. So water would roll out through the canyons out into the North Seas of Mars. And if it did have water, it was long-standing, could have evolved life. Now this is one of my favorite shots from the Opportunity rover. What's really cool about this is there are three ways to drive a rover. The first way is you tell each of its six wheels how many degrees to turn. The next level of sophistication, you tell each wheel how many degrees to turn, but the rover will decide whether it wants to do what you're telling it to do. So if I tell it to drive off a cliff, it'll come up to it and say, nah, I'm not doing that. The most sophisticated and dangerous way to drive a rover is we call it autonomous navigation, where we say, okay, rover, you're here, you figured out, how would you leave this room? And it would look around and figure out the way to go. Well, this is the Victoria Crater. You can see the tracks. It stopped when it saw this pile of rocks. It then turned and went around it. We didn't command it. This was the rover doing it on its own. So we're already doing autonomous drive. It makes us a little antsy when these things do it. Because when you have $800 million of rover, it'll just say, do stuff, we'll trust you. It's giving you a nerve wreck. Well, you can see where this thing went. It came from the Eagle Crater, went all the way down, and we're circling the Big Endeavor Crater. We like craters and walls. They're the most dangerous from a safety point of view, but it's the most interesting. If I have a rock on the surface and I pick it up, I can tell you what it's made of, and that's it. If I have bedrock, I know not only what it's made of, but I actually know it was made there, and it's stratified. So I can actually chronologically figure out the context of that rock. So even though they're the most dangerous places to go, we like exploring craters. It's also tough if you're on the base floor of the crater and you're solar powered and you go close to a wall, you can get shadowed and then you just die there. So it can be very, very risky. We also found with the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter that even at mid-latitudes, you may see these craters, but if you penetrate with a radar, you can see that they're really water ice. So there's water ice, not necessarily at the poles, but also at mid-latitudes. We like water ice because you can melt it down and drink it, or you can, after you make it a liquid, split it into hydrogen and oxygen, liquefy it, and now you have a fuel and oxidize it. We've seen these, and this is really weird. See these brown lines? These brown lines have the really ugly name called RSLs, for recurring slope lineae. They're these linear features that only appear in the springtime. As you get to Martian summer, they get lighter and lighter and disappear. You don't see them in the fall, you don't see them in the winter, but they reappear again in the spring. This has led some people to speculate that this stuff could be flowing salt water right underneath the surface today. We know that wherever you have water on Earth, you have life. is this salt water versus carbon dioxide flow or some other kind of theory that people talk about? And if it is salt water, could you have life there today? If you have fossilized life on Mars or you have life on Mars that you can analyze, then you get to ask the next set of questions. Did life start on Earth and then jump to Mars? Or did it start on Mars and jump to Earth? Or did you have two genesis in one solar system? We'd love to find that out. You know, there's a great quote by Arthur C. Clarke that says, sometimes I think we're alone in the universe, sometimes I think we're not. Either answer is terrifying. MRO, the Mars Reconnaissance Orbiter, also has the biggest telescope we've ever flown away from the Earth. This is a picture of the surface of Mars, and one of the things that we're seeing, which is really wild, we see these black spots on the surface of Mars, and you're going, black spots? What are these? Well, when you look at them close up, you see that they're cave openings. One of the things we'd like to do is actually land in these caves and see if they actually travel. We think they're like magma tubes underneath the surface of Mars that dried up 3 billion years ago. And now there are these tunnels, and what these black spots are is this is when parts of the top cave in, forming skylights. So one of the challenges we're asked to do is, how would you do a skylight mission to drive in these subterranean tunnels? Because the tunnels would be, have more atmosphere in them, it would moderate the temperature, it would protect you from radiation. Could you have something fun going on here? Then we had good old, look at the sound again, okay. This is what we do with Opportunity. We're coming in at about 13,000 miles an hour. We lose the crew stage, and there go the weights. That's like 80 kilograms of mass there. So we come in at an angle, 13,000 miles per hour. I gotta go kilometers. 20,000 miles per hour-ish. We do 4 minutes on the heat shield, and then when we slow up, that point, what you're gonna do is you're now gonna get rid of the heat shield. That's not that. The back of that cone, that's where the parachute is. So once we slow up, we then have to fire the bolts that release the heat shield. So we straighten up first, there go the other weights, and we straighten up, and then we drop up the heat shield. So the parachute first, then the heat shield. And what we're gonna do is, we actually expose the rover itself. As we go down, it's wearing a jetpack. We pressurize the pack, and then we just drop the whole mess. Fire rockets, the jet engines are candid so we don't do plume all over the rover. It's got a radar in front, this yellow thing, and that's looking at the ground to actually see where the surface is, so it's got an idea of where it's trying to park, and it's looking at what it sees and trying to match the two. And then when we get close, that's the MARTI camera, the MARTI descent energy, that's taking pictures as we come down. And then what we'll do is lower the thing down over the sense thing. So it's on four cables, three are structural, one is power command to the sense stage. And we're waiting until the speed slows up. And it slows up once it touches the ground. And as soon as it touches the ground, cut the cords, and then the descent stage metal load just flies off and burns the completion of this crash. Piece of cake. That's got to be the scariest 7 minutes, and we're going to do this again. But we've been driving on the surface since 2012. The circles are where we landed. That's called Mount Sharp, which is about 14,000 at 21,000 kilometer feet, 1,000 meters. I don't know the height. It's Mount Rainier in the States. It's a high mountain peak. I'm just gonna go up there. So you can see where we landed. There's the sky crane impact. There's where the shell and the parachute fell off. What we did from the landing side, we first went the wrong way away from the mountain to actually get to see these different rock formations before we came back around. They don't do this all the time, so this is a little bit old. This is from March of 2016. You can see the path that we're taking as we head our way to the mountain, because we really want to see the bedrocks there. One of the tricks we do, and this is what it looks like to be on the surface of Mars, the other thing that's different that's kind of neat is we call this white balance. For geologists, when you're looking through a Martian atmosphere, it's really very brown and dark. So what we do is we take that photograph from a piece of Mars, and we bring it as if it was on Earth, and we give it the same lighting conditions as if it's on Earth, so that you can actually see the stratification. It's much easier for the geologist to find minerals out there. We're heading to this. This is foothills of Mount Sharp. You can see the stratification, and each one of those bands will be a different history of what's going on with Mars. So we can start in the bottom when Mars was supposedly wet and actually see how the planet evolved as we go higher and higher up there. We're having a little problem with our wheels because the rocks are really trashing the wheels, but we're still working our way up towards the peak. One of the theories about Mars was that when Mars had a magnetic field, it was shielding the planet from the solar wind, but as the core cooled, the magnetic field turned off, and then the solar wind would knock into the atmosphere, knocking away the atmospheres, so the pressure would fall, so at one point the ocean just boil off and freeze. We think that'll happen to the Earth at one point, but MAVEN, which is built by the Goddard Space Flight Center, is around Mars right now and is trying to understand this mechanism of how we lose a planetary atmosphere. Because what happens to some of these guys will happen to us. This mission, InSight, was supposed to go in 2016, but we weren't ready because it's got a seismometer. The deal is to try to put a seismometer on the surface of Mars and see if Mars has quakes. To give you an idea how sensitive that seismometer is, if we put it on successfully on the surface of Mars, it can detect a magnitude 3 earthquake anywhere on the planet. We can see ground motion the size of a hydrogen atom. And when they were working on this thing in the United States to try to convert it to this place, if they were working on this thing in Melbourne, they would have a problem with vibrations from waves hitting the beach in Brisbane. So this is just one heck of a seismometer, and that's why we have to have it evacuated, because even a little bit of atmospheric gases will disturb it. Well, the Sky Crane and the Curiosity rover were such a hit that Congress gave us money to do another rover. So we're doing the exact same one, but with different instruments. Two of the fun ones, one of our fantasies is that you can launch on a small rocket with only fuel for a one-way trip when we want to come back. And what you do is you land on the surface of Mars, you would dig up the ice, you take the ice, separate it to hydrogen and oxygen, and then liquefy it, and then you suck in carbon dioxide, split into carbons and oxygen, put the carbons with the hydrogen and make liquid methane, and put the oxygen and oxygen to make fuel and re-oxidizer and then fill your tanks. So it's called in situ resource utilization. You're using the resources that are there. One of the 2020 payloads is a instrument to ingest carbon dioxide and crack it and see how much oxygen it can make. And one of the other things that we're going to do on this thing, and we're not sure it's going to go, but we're working as if it is. In 1997 with Mars Pathfinder, we had a little rover called Sojourner that drove off, and Sojourner was such a hit to have mobility that we then had Spirit, Opportunity, Curiosity, and the 2020 rover. What we're doing on this one, one of the challenges on the rover, even with stereoscopic vision, if you have a bunch of sand dunes, you can't see which way to go. What happens if there's a cliff on one side and there's a femur sticking on the other side? You want to go to the femur. Well, because we can't see over the dunes, even with stereoscopic vision, we're going to put room for a 1 kilogram helicopter on this thing, or call it a drone. That's just going to be solar powered. It's going to go up, look around, and then signal to the rover what the terrain looks like so we can decide on which way to go. And right now we've already done tests where we've built a 1 kilogram drone, put it in a vacuum chamber, sucked up the atmosphere until 7,000 of an atmosphere, and we were able to generate lift. So we think we can build a drone that works in that environment. Where we eventually want to get to is we want the 2020 rover to put samples all over Mars where it's been driving. We then have this fetch rover collect those samples, bring it to a launch vehicle, and then we blast off those samples. So the samples would come here, and then an orbiting spacecraft would collect the samples, and we bring the samples home to be the first sample return from another world. Other than the moon. Moon doesn't count. The other thing that we want to do, which is really kind of wild, is, and people don't realize this, if I had a balance beam scale, and on the left side I put all the life forms that I know and love on planet Earth, so from the atmosphere I take birds, bugs, bees, from the ground I take trees and shrubbery and cats and dogs and people, from the ocean, plankton and coral and fishies and crabbies and those guys, there's a certain amount of mass associated with all those life forms. On the other side, I put what are called lithotroph, the single cell guys that live in the bedrocks. I put all that on this side of the balance beam. That side weighs more. So there's more mass tied up with lithotrophs than everything else combined on the planet. So we're not the dominant species, just the most egotistical. Matter of fact, the funny part is people are built the same way. If I take you and I put all your cells on the balance beam, and on the other side I take all the bacteria and germs that are living on and in you, you're a terrarium for bacteria. It's kind of weird, but that's how we're built. So we're built like planets. Now let's go to the outer solar system. This is the shot from Cassini that's been orbiting Saturn. The first thing that people don't realize, if I had the top part of this picture of the ring touch the Earth, this side would touch the moon. So the next time you see the moon, Saturn just fits in between these two things, even though it's only about 100 meters thick. Let me just jump to the end with Cassini. Cassini's been orbiting this thing since 2004. When we die, we have to do something with the spacecraft because we're running out of fuel. So we always try to do something risky but entertaining, something scientifically cool. Starting in April of 2017, this is the A ring. Cassini division is a B ring, a C, and a D ring. We are going to come over the top of Saturn, and we're going to try to come in between the D ring and the atmosphere and see if we survive. And if we survive, we think we can do that 22 times before we spiral into the planet itself. So that depth dive is going to start April next year. One of the biggest disappointments from the Voyager program was Titan. Titan was just a gas ball. It's got an atmosphere that's 1.5 times as thick as this, so you're sitting in one atmosphere that's 1.5 atmospheres. You guys are breathing 78% nitrogen, this is 99% nitrogen. The two major differences is one, there's no oxygen, but you don't need oxygen for life. And two, it's really cold. Way cold in this place. But with Cassini, we brought the right instruments, radars and different types of infrared, where you could actually see through the surface. And then with the Huygens probe, we could see river channels, and it's not river of water, because water would freeze at those temperatures. It's ethane. So you have ethane rivers that go into ethane lakes that go into ethane oceans. What's really cool about this place is, since the atmosphere is 1.5 times as thick as the stuff we're sitting in right now, but it's got the mass of the moon, when it rains on Titan, the raindrops fall slow. Which must be such a trippy thing to be seeing. You'll also notice, so Huygens actually made it to the surface. So you're looking at the surface of Titan here. You'll notice that the rocks are kind of rounded. That means there's weathering going on. So this really is a dynamic environment with probably rain and snow and things moving to really erode these rocks. But we're the first generation of human beings to be able to see that picture. We also were surprised by Enceladus. On the left is an actual photograph where we see plumes erupting out of the surface. And it's liquid water, and there's some salts. There's little organics. There's also some silica. Think of fine-grained dirt. Which we think means it's coming from hydrothermal vents, is the mechanism that's heating this thing up. So we got these geysers. One of the things we did with Cassini is we actually flew through those plumes. We call those passes the Cassini car wash. We go through it, and that's how we found out what's going on, and a lot of people think that Enceladus may still have life. Pluto, that's the best Pluto looked like from the ground. And then when New Horizons got there, it looked like that. What was really weird is this is a close-up picture of Pluto. If you said Pluto wouldn't have any craters on it, that it's going to be smooth and irregular, we would have thought you were nuts. So now you have to come up with a way of explaining these things. We know that the nitrogen and methane that you see on the surface can't support peaks that tall. So we believe it's water ice mountains with this stuff on it. They even made a movie of this stuff. So if you look at Titan, excuse me, Pluto, that's the region we're going to fly over at close range. And you just look at the surface and realize that you're looking at Pluto. So you've got these cratered kind of terrains, sub-cratering. You've got a lot of frost on the surface. You've got these mottled regions, and you're just looking like, what is going on in this place? But that's about a year old. What we just did is with the Juno spacecraft, it's the first solar-powered spacecraft to go out to Jupiter. Jupiter has these massive donuts of radiation. We came up with an idea of how to go past that region without getting fried. We come in from the top, and then we dive down. We did this already to avoid the radiation, and we're going to do these pedals, 37 pedals each time going around, to try to look inside the inside of Jupiter, because right now we don't know how planets are formed. It's really embarrassing. Here we are studying planets, and we don't know how they're formed. We also got approval to do a Europa mission, which would orbit Europa and also a lander. The reason why I like Europa, which is the Jupiter system, is we think it's got 1, 2, 5, 10 kilometer thick ocean ice with a liquid water ocean that's got a volume that's twice the amount of water as all the liquid water on the Earth. And we think it's got a rocky bottom that's got geothermal activity. We think the moment, you know, if you could get through the 10 kilometers of ice and explore this region, we think the best place to explore is right underneath the ice. And the reason why is the heat would set up these convection cells that would go around to study under the ice, and then radiation from Jupiter hits the top and stuff falls in. So we're saying, okay, how would you explore the bottom of the ice field on Jupiter? This is one of the things we're working on. This is called Brewery. We went up to Alaska where we had a frozen lake. We pull out an ice plug. We were actually with National Geographic, so we dumped a camera in there so we could look up at this thing. That's baby Brewery. You take Brewery and you drop it into this lake, and as you push it under, the guy is buoyant, it floats. And then what you do is you drive it along the bottom of the ice. Now, we still have to figure out how to get it out, you know, 500 million miles. You got to figure out how to go through 10 kilometers of ice. You got to figure out how to solve the radiation. You got to figure out how to get commands to this thing. You got to figure out how to get data out of it. But right now, we're working on the mobility of the system. I mean, what we are trying to do is develop new capabilities to do new things. Now, Europa, around Jupiter, we think it's just this ice world, but in 2012, we actually found a little bit of hydrogen oxygen off the limb of this thing, which led some people to speculate that it's venting. We don't know if it's active. It could have just been some sort of comet or asteroid smashing into the surface, but there was this one-time-only measurement, and we'd love to get the stuff from the water out so we can actually explore what's there. We would also like to go back to Titan. This is the one with the slow rain. We'd like to build an orbiter, we'd love to have a boat, and we'd love to have a balloon with a gondola that would just float in the atmosphere. We call those things aerobots. We're also studying minor bodies, comets and asteroids. This is the asteroid that Rosetta has been studying, and September 30th it's actually going to park on the surface of this place. We visit asteroids. This is Vesta that we're around. Do you remember the first Star Wars films? You had your X-Wing vehicles and your TIE fighters. TIE is an acronym for twin ion engines, and we're flying ion engines today. Because they're 10 times more efficient, you can't use them to blast off a planet. You can see that Vesta is really pretty large compared to asteroids that we've been by already. and now we're orbiting Ceres. God, it is. Can't turn this out. So. Anyways, we take data and we actually model what these things look like. We think this was a dead ocean world because it's got some regions of bright spots that we think are hydrated salts. OSIRIS-REx is going to launch September 8th. This is another Goddard mission, another NASA center. But this one's going to go out to an asteroid to get samples and bring it back to the Earth. Now here's where I get to scare you guys. This is our solar system in 1800. Every red dot you see is an asteroid that crosses Earth's orbit, and green is one that's outside of Earth's orbit. You shouldn't see any 1800. By 1900, this is what we knew of. Now let me do truth in advertising. You can't preserve the diameter of the object and your distance scale in the same plot, because these asteroids are not the same size as Mars. But I want to illustrate a point. This is 1900, how many asteroids we knew. This is 1950, 1990, 1999, 2016. There are over 709,706 minor bodies. 12,430 are near-Earth objects. They come near us. 1,570 are potentially hazardous objects. Now let me give you an idea of what potentially hazardous means. In 1995, a comet came too close to Jupiter and the tidal forces of Jupiter pulled it into 23 pieces. We weren't that creative, Andy. It was the A fragment, the B fragment, the C fragment, went to W. The G fragment was the big piece. It was about 1.6 kilometers. When that 1.6 kilometer object slammed into Jupiter, we calculated that it released 6 million megatons of TNT. Now, I don't know about you guys, when I hear million and mega in the same sentence, it doesn't mean anything to me. So we tried to come up with a good way of describing what 6 million megatons of TNT would feel like. You can get that amount of energy if you took one of the small atomic bombs that we did, you know, in the 1940s and 50s. You would have to take one of those and drop one every second. I love looking at my watch because it's totally pointless. Do this every second for 11 years. That's why one of these things would be a bad day. There's a joke that we rip off from Larry Niven, the science fiction writer, that says, the reason why the dinosaurs aren't alive today is because they didn't have a space program. So we'd like to know about these things, and we'd like to be able to either use resources from them or deflect them. So one of the missions that we're looking at is, can we use the new space launch system, the SLS, and an Orion capsule, and go to one of these? And we found that bringing humans to asteroid, that's kind of a tough thing. So one of the ideas was to do this. Let's go to an asteroid, map it, pick up a boulder, and jump off with it. Leave the asteroid with this thing, and one of the things we're going to try to do is a gravitational tug, where we just parallel park next to the asteroid and we see if the mutual gravity can actually pull the asteroid off course. So if you ever wanted to deflect one of these things, you could do it with a gravitational tug. We want to do it after we have more mass, so we have a little more gravitational traction, to see if we can actually deflect an asteroid. And then we want to bring it to the moon. And it'll orbit the moon, and then the astronauts can go visit it anytime they want, for only 3.5 day journey. So that's called the Asteroid Redirect Mission. Right now it's still funding, it's in phase B, but we'll see if it's legit or not. And then finally, the last area, deep space, the universe. Do you get Orion down here?
Yeah.
Okay, all right. Here's Orion visible light, you got Betelgeuse, Rigel, you got Orion Nebula. The exact same photo in infrared would be this. And you can see that the sword region is really a stellar nursery. Here's looking at Orion in ultraviolet light and in X-rays. And that's why we have different types of telescopes, because they're all looking at different wavelengths to understand what's going on. So Hubble was visible in ultraviolet, Spitzer was infrared, Chandra was X-rays, Compton was gamma rays. We're all trying to understand what's going on. Now, this picture's old, but I think people don't do it justice. This is the Eagle Nebula, 7,000 light years away. That little bat wing, that's the shape of the Hubble field of view. If you focus in on it, you see these pillars. These pillars are, let's see, 9.5 light years, 56 trillion miles, and another 25, call it 75 trillion miles is one of these pillars. Okay? Inside here, gas and dust is coming together. As this gas and dust comes together, when it gets about 12, 15 million degrees, it starts to fire as a fusion, comes around, and then blows things away, and that's how you make new suns. So this is a stellar nursery. What's really cool is there's a star nearby that is basically eating away the dust from this thing. So if you're this proto-sun, the dust cloud starts to get eaten away and you stick out. If I do a close-up of this pillar, you see those little fingers that are sticking up? You're seeing baby suns being eaten out of their stellar nursery. The scale of things, if you look at one of those little thumbs, from one side to the other side is 10 times the size of our solar system. It's huge. With infrared, this is a Spitzer telescope. When you look in infrared at a garden variety galaxy, you can see where all the active galaxies are in infrared because they're much brighter. This would be like having some sort of soccer stadium and you give anybody that's 10 years of age younger a flashlight. They go into the stadium and then when they're seated, you turn the light up in the stadium and you have all the kids turn their flashlights so you can see where all the youngsters are sitting. I'm going to show you where all the youngsters are sitting in M81. Does this mean that galaxies also have habitable zones? Don't know. But we're really starting to piece together how these things work. This is the Hubble Deep Field photo. This is the Ultra Deep Field. It's been around for a while, but it's just very mind-numbing. The director of the Space Telescope Institute wanted to look at a piece of sky no bigger than a grain of rice held at arm's distance. After the guy did it, they got this picture, which has over 3,000 dots in it. What's wild is if you look at this guy, this is called a diffraction. Of the 3,000 dots, only 5 of them have diffraction patterns. 2, 3, 4, 5. Those 5 are 5 of the 400 billion suns in the Milky Way galaxy. Everything else in this picture, you're looking past the Milky Way galaxy and other galaxies of hundreds of billions of suns. Do you have any idea how insignificant we are? No. And this is only one little part of the sky, and you can't even see the stuff that's redshifted out of the visible. So one of the things we've been trying to do is to look for planets, exoplanets, planets around stars. This is the Kepler telescope, and what we do is we look at one part of the sky, and we just sit there for basically years. And what we're doing is we're looking for what's called transits, which is when an exoplanet that's seen from Earth cuts in front of a star so the starlight winks out. And to make sure it's not an asteroid in our system that's doing it, it's just bad luck. We say you have to have 3 transits, 3 winking out events before we're convinced that it's a planet around that star system. So we're looking at, which guy? Come on. That guy. What happens is when things are around it, the thing will wink out. Now this is exceedingly sped up, but these transit events could go for hours long. And of course this technique is biased to finding big things and close, and indeed it does. So we've been finding these oddballs. We first started seeing hot Jupiters, which are these Jupiter-sized objects that are so close to their sun that a year would take a couple of Earth days long. We don't even know how you get Jupiters that close in. We also found these things. We found Jupiter-class planets that got kicked out of their solar system and are just floating in space away from their star. We call them orphan worlds. And then, we even have this, and I mean, this is not a picture that we've seen, this is just a model. We find what we believe are called ocean worlds, where this thing has no surface, it's just the ocean over the top of this thing. So we're finding just this wild variety of these things. If you look at the current count, and this thing changes all the time, so it's probably not right, but what you feel, we have over 5,700 of these things identified. 309 of these things are Earth-sized, and 20 of these guys are Earth-sized in what we call the habitable zone, where we have the water. we're not even sure you need to be in the habitable zone anymore because on the Earth, in our system, we're finding worlds with subterranean oceans. So maybe Earth is the oddball. We have the oceans on the outside. Maybe you don't need to be in a habitable zone to have life. So one of the things we're working at is you want to be able to block the light from the star so you can see planets nearby. One of our ideas that we're working on is this. This is called the star shade. There's the telescope. That's the star shade. You do the first deploy, and then a second one. This thing is maybe about 30 meters across, with panels that are about 3 meters. You then send this thing down about, I don't know, 10, 20, 30,000 kilometers, and you line it up so as it moves in front of the star, it suppresses the starlight so you can see the planets going around it. That's called a star shade. We're working on that now. And then we've got future concepts that are further downrange, where we're doing something called a coronagraph, where we put this collar on it to block light, or free-flying spacecraft that communicate to one spacecraft that do an image on the top. What that top image is you're blocking out the light from the central star, and you're actually detecting light from those planets. If you do that, and you look at the spectra given off, if you have features for gases that shouldn't be there, kind of like ozone, it could be a biomarker, it could mean life. Because what we're trying to do is we're trying to find the Terra Novas, the new stars. Why do we do this? There's basically three reasons for doing it. We're trying to explore our universe because basically we're curious. Next, once we explore another world, we use that to help explain the Earth, to better understand the Earth. And then third, you have all the technology droppings. If you think of anybody that was alive in 1916 versus 2016, ask yourself how the world has changed. Longer standard, high standard of living, longer life expectancies, control of more information and resources. It's through learning. You can close down NASA as long as you're doing fundamental research. Space just happens to be infinite, so space is really a good way to do this. I'm going to end now with a set of three images. The one on your left is the Earth seen from low Earth orbit. The one in the middle is the Earth as seen from the moon. On the right, if you look at that circle in there, there's a dot. That's the Earth as seen from Mars. And going one step further, this is Cassini looking, this is Saturn looking back at the sun taken by Cassini. If you look at that circle, which was really enhanced, that's the Earth from 1.6 billion kilometers away. But I end with a quote by Konstantina Vardabysiokoski, one of my heroes. The Earth is the cradle of the mind, but one cannot live in the cradle forever. Thank you.
Budget for NASA and the JPL is not like less than a percent of the tax dollar.
Yep.
So what message do you get across to Congress to say that the more money invested in space exploration is not a waste, but more so a moving force, an impetus for us to move forward and project that technology?
There are a number of forces in any government, whether it's Australia or US, where people have to decide and make tough decisions about where resources get allocated to. I can't tell you the number of times people would say, why are we investing in space? There's no benefit from it. We've got homeless, we have maladies, we have all sorts of issues. The best we can do is explain where the benefits are. And we do that both from a technology point of view and from a standard of living point of view. I mean, if you look at your cell phone, the camera in there, that came out of JPL. We're the ones that made an instrument on a chip. It was an active pixel sensor. So all we can tell them is say, look, we are responding to the science community of what these guys want to do. Yes, it's fundamental research, but you're going to stimulate good jobs, you're going to stimulate technology in the technology sector, you're going to keep moving forward. It is a very difficult question, so like if you look at the presidential elections that are going on today, no one really has made any statement about space, and maybe even rightly so, because of the burning issues that we have on this planet. Space isn't that high up, but it is a serious issue. We do have to understand how to take care of this planet, and I believe we really will be a spacefaring nation. Can you picture actually taking all heavy industry off of the Earth and putting it on the Moon and leaving Earth as a biosphere? I mean, there are really cool things you can do. It's just a hard message to get across when you have competing issues. Another question? Yeah?
So far, you haven't used electrical or any other advanced propulsion system much in space boats, particularly the deep space ones to the Aeronautics. Now, is there any reason for this, rather than using all these gravitational assist movers, which take ages to get there? Is it, if you're going to say it's just cost, well, is this because not enough research was done in the early days to develop this propulsion system so that it becomes routine now, or what?
I guess to paraphrase the question is there doesn't seem to be that much use. People have not been using electric propulsion that much. Electric propulsion, basically, it's you're trying to throw something as fast as you can out one way, so Newton's third law, you go the other way. And we find that electric propulsion, where you take xenon, a heavy atom, you rip off the electrons, and then you glow these things out the back, is really 10 times more efficient than the way we're currently flying today. We see that electric propulsion is really good, but it's a difficult technology, and right now, when we talk about electric propulsion, we call it solar electric propulsion, because using sunlight to drive the system to run the grids and the accelerator and the ionized things. That means we're tied to the sun, inner solar system stuff. When you're doing deep space, you can't use electric propulsion because we need a way to actually power the thing when you're away from the sun. So what we call solar electric propulsion SEPs, one area we'd like to get to is then called NEPs, nuclear electric propulsion, because now you free yourself from the sun and now you can really start moving out into the solar system. But a lot of the world is not really positive about sending nuclear reactors into space. So, and you know, between blitzes and understanding people's motives, the impetus to do nuclear electric propulsion is really low. I will tell you that some people are doing a really far end research. So Stephen Hawking and this researcher from Russia, was it?
Yuri Miller.
There you go. Spending lots of money to try to see if they can accelerate a postage stamp spacecraft to Proxima Centauri in 20 years. Now, I don't think we'll be doing that in anybody's lifetime here, but hey, you got to start somewhere. We're trying to learn how to do that, because if you can actually free the spacecraft from power and propulsion and retransmit it to it, that could really open up the solar system. But electric propulsion we are using more and more, but typically that's the inner solar system. Yeah?
What do you see, what's understood in your world to be, what are they, to be the barriers, two or three barriers that we're talking about in the exploration? Are they propulsion? Are they autonomy? Are they transmission? What I thought to be the big questions to be answered in the next 10 years is there an argument that says, let's just wait and try to see in 20 years' time to deal with things quicker, differently?
The question is, what are the barriers to space exploration? And waiting, I don't believe, is a viable alternative. We may not be ready to do something, but we still have to keep pushing it. So we have different class of missions. So a Discovery class mission is a $500 million class where we don't use technology. That's just simply funding. How often Congress will give NASA money to do these things. Flagship missions get to be $1 to $2 billion, and those can have new technology. We like autonomy, but we have a problem with autonomous spacecraft. If I say I'm going to make autonomous spacecraft, here's $2 billion, go build it, you now have to trust it. And I think, you know, we have this war at the laboratory. You got one camp that says, I'm going to make my spacecraft as dumb as possible. I'm going to have a whole team that's going to operate the spacecraft and simulate everything to make sure I think what I'm sending it can do, and then just send it to the spacecraft. You got the other side that says, I'm going to make this spacecraft as sophisticated as possible, and autonomy is one of those things, and then I'm just going to have to trust it.
So, are there two schools of thought? Is there an effort on either camp?
There's efforts on both to do that. So you can see that we're doing autonomous navigation, we've done autonomous driving, we do that slowly. Our capability isn't really quite up there yet. We find that bottlenecks are telecommunications, so we're moving from radio frequencies to optical communications is one area we're working on. Propulsion is another way. One of our goals that we're trying to do is to go 10 times faster than Voyager. And for comparison, from here to Neptune would take 31 years. Voyager did it in 12 years. Which I think is a wild concept. That's great. One of the ideas that we looked at, we were trying to see how we could go fast, 10 times faster than Voyager, and we just don't know how to push something that fast. But one of the things that we see out of nature is you've got your galaxy, the Milky Galaxy. We've got these things called hypervelocity stars that are leaving the galaxy at a fraction of the speed of light. And the question is, how do you get a star to move at half, a fraction of the speed of light? And what we think is going on is, when you look at stars at night, over 60% of these things are either double or triple star systems. We think these hypervelocity stars come from a double star system that comes so close to the supermassive black hole in the center of the galaxy that one rips off, kicking out the other star out of the galaxy. So we said, hey, why can't we do that? So one of these crazy ideas is to take a spacecraft, orbit an asteroid, send the asteroid spacecraft pair out to Jupiter, make a U-turn around Jupiter, that's miracle one, send it within one solar radii of the sun, that's miracle two, rip off the asteroid, not the spacecraft, transfer all the momentum to the spacecraft kicking it out, because we don't care where the spacecraft goes, we just want to push it fast. But that's a few miracles away to be able to do that. So I think we're trying to push all eight classical systems with spacecraft, trying to figure out how to do this. Because, we'd like to do autonomous spacecraft, things that actually dock together to maybe make a really big telescope lens. We'd love to do more autonomy, if we can trust it. We put on fault protection algorithms on spacecraft, and you hope you never use it. Because the spacecraft is going to take care of itself, and this is a very unforgiving business. It doesn't take much to use a spacecraft. Because all we have is this tenuous radio link between us and them. But we keep trying to push the state of the art. Another question? Yeah.
Humans on Mars, so what's the current, what are the challenges that we still face for that dream to come to reality?
The question is, human on Mars, what's the challenge? I think the first is money. I also think it's the will to do so. And maybe I'm going to ask the question to these guys, you guys. I want you to raise your hand. Which would you rather do? The two choices are humans to Mars or colony on the moon. How many people say, I want to send humans to Mars? How many people say, I want to put a colony on the moon? Great split. there's a limited budget to do this. Right now, we were asked to come up with a mission design. We weren't doing it. The Johnson Space Center was there. This was us, JPL. How would you move assets around, and what could you do? And we said, under the following conditions, if space station does indeed end in 2025, if that money that was used for space station went to NASA, it wasn't taken back by Congress. If that money that wasn't taken back, we put into a human exploration of Mars, we could get humans to Phobos, one of the moons of Mars, in 2033, and onto the surface in 2036. Now, that presupposes that there's a will to do so. I think right now, just as you guys are split, our government is split of really where do you go next. There's some people that want to continue building space stations. There's some people that want to put, a station distant around the moon. There's some people that want to put it on the moon. Some people want to send humans to Mars. And you have to figure out what are you going to do from both technology, from an inspiration point of view, to progressing the field of knowledge. If you send humans to Mars, would you just be doing the Apollo program all over again, where you do 2, 3, 4 missions there and then you're done? So this is something we're wrestling with. I think we have the technology to do this now. A human transfer from here to Mars takes 11 months. A small spacecraft can get there in 8.5 months. Say you can do some magic and get there in 6 months. say it takes 6 months back, say you have to stay a full 26 months on the surface for the next opportunity to come back, say you can do this in 6 months or a year, you're talking about a 2 to 3 year mission. Maybe you start with a crew of 6 and then you get budget cutbacks and you do a crew of 4. How many times will we do this? I understand the inspiration, planting the flag, we're also a Martian, but it would push a lot of the technology. How much of the problems of the Earth does that solve? And I, again, fundamental research shouldn't necessarily be directed at problems on the Earth. We need to be looking forward. That's how we inspire the, you guys, the next generation of people to do this, and how we just move the species forward. I'd love to be living on multiple bodies. Yeah?
Right, thanks for the talk. You mentioned in-situ resource utilization and SpaceX. I was wondering if you could comment on what you see the role of private space companies.
So this is not necessarily an ISRU question, and this is more about SpaceX and the private sector.
So, for example, putting deposits of fuel in space in low Earth orbit for easy access?
One of the things that we're supposed to do at NASA, this is one of the things I love about NASA, is if you look in our charter, in 1958 when we created, besides just doing things like, you know, aerodynamic research, aeronautics, astronautics, deep space, robotics, it says we have to help the economic competitiveness of the United States, and we have to train the next generations of scientists and engineers. That's why we're always doing this public outreach stuff all the time. When it comes to space exploration and commercialization, NASA was not created in 1958 to start a communication satellite business, a weather satellite business, a remote sensing satellite business, a GPS satellite business. Those are all the ones that went commercial, and they're just full-blown industries. So we're here to really help set up capabilities. Once we get a capability, we pass out to industry to let them go forward. So when it comes to these companies, I love these companies going forward. You know, if SpaceX can really make these things reusable and actually knock down the price, great. If people can do planetary resource, do mining for resources out in the asteroid belt, great. We just want to do stuff that no one has ever done before. So we want to take something that's a dream and make it a reality. So there's a quote by Goddard that says, you know, the hopes of yesterday are the dreams of yesterday are the hopes of today and the realities of tomorrow. So we are just trying to develop this capability. So any way we can push the commercial sector, we thought remote sensing, material processing, making stuff in space would be next. But it looks like tourism is going up. I believe that you're going to have hotels in low Earth orbit probably within 20 years. It'll be kind of Spartan and it'll be kind of pricey, but it'll start there. And I believe, I tell my kids that they're the last generations of human beings to look up at the moon and be able to say, I remember when there were no lights on it. And it sounds funny now, but it's not that far, guys. It really isn't. Especially if there's an economically viable reason for doing it. You know, if you could mine your oxygen and your lunas on the moon and then put it into orbit around the Earth rather than always coming in and out of that gravitational well, that assumes you don't really have a cheap way of getting to space yet, which Elon Musk is trying to do. But any way we can get the private sector to set up a space business, we love it. We think that's the best way to go. Yeah.
I'm with you all the way. I really, really appreciate this. But in the United States, we had a lecturer here last year or the year before, and he was saying that about 50% of the young people under age 25 in the United States don't believe that the alarms are actually going on the moon.
That's not that bad, but yeah. I think there is a lot of misinformation out there, and I think people like conspiracy theories and stuff. What we need to do is we need to educate our next generation. One of the reasons why I do this, because I believe the most important thing someone can do as an individual, a nation, and a species is learn. And learning is broken up into two pieces. Research and exploration to get the information, and teaching to pass it on. Okay? There will always be people on the bottom of a rung compared to the top of a rung. There will always be people that will doubt these things. You know, the next time you see someone who said we didn't land on the moon, you go, okay, do you believe we orbited the moon? How about the Gemini program? Was the Gemini fake? How about the Mercury program? I mean, where do you draw the line?
Yeah.
People love these sensational stories, but it's because they like sensational stories. There's no fact behind it. And there are too many people really just worried about getting through life
and really looking at things logically and with open mind. And yeah, it is embarrassing for people to say there is climate change, that the Earth is flat, that we're never going. You can go on and on with this stuff. But I think you'll always have them out there. Those are the people hopefully we're not counting on to move society forward. Hopefully. Here's a lot of them.
Okay. NASA, what is about election in the U.S.
Is NASA worried about the election in the U.S.? Right now, neither candidate has said much about the space program, and we find that we have to figure out who's going to do what and where their emphasis is. When George W. Bush did the Constellation program in 2004, JPL lost three $1 billion plus missions. We basically are at the whatever the administration wants us to do. So we're not necessarily worried, we're just curious what direction we'll be asked to do. We may be asked to go, we're going to do a lunar colony on the moon, and before the astronauts get there, we want to robotically assemble this thing, so that would be on our wheelhouse. That would be for us to come develop that capability, so that you can put this thing together so when they land, there's a habitat there. And it first would be human tended. So I think we're always curious about who gets elected. I will tell you that my job specifically, I can see my work change as a function of who's elected. And not everybody in the United States can make their claim. You know, a president comes in and wants to do something that's completely different than what JPL is doing, that work just disappears. You go like, okay, now what? So yeah, like the rest of the world, we're trying to see what the United States population is going to do, and we hope it's enlightened. But that's really the best we can do. Yeah?
I've always believed that you should look at how others get somewhere if you want to get to that place. And I'm just wondering, how did you get into propulsion at JPL? Like, it's kind of the...
Oh, there's no question. How did I get there personally? How did you? This is great. My dad gave me two pieces of advice growing up, and I'm going to pass it on to all you guys that are starting out a career. The two secrets to life is, one, whatever you do for a career, make sure it's something you love, and marry somebody who can cook. That's how I know what that is. Those are secrets. So what I would tell you is you want to find something that's your passion. It doesn't matter if it's space or not. It's something that we talk about the lotto test. We have a lottery in the United States. I don't know if you have a lotto down here.
Yeah.
You want to ask yourself, if you won the lottery, would you still show up at work on Monday? And I know I would. I'd have longer vacations. I'd probably hear you soaring. I would have longer vacations, but I fundamentally love what I'm doing. So the first trick is you want to find out what you love doing. Next, you don't want to give up. Should I do the embarrassing thing? Okay, I'm going to do the embarrassing thing. I'm going to first tell you my credentials, and then I'm going to tell you the truth. Well, you heard my credentials, so I'll tell you the truth. I was a C student in calculus, and it took me 5 years to get my bachelor's. I had the lowest GPA possible that is barely high enough to get a master's. This work took a high priority. I found a relatively easy way to get a PhD, relatively easy. I became a fellow of the Royal Astronautical Society because I had drinks with them on their 150th anniversary. I'm condoning drinking. I had an asteroid named after me because I was on a speaker's gig with another individual that was searching for minor bodies and he just needed another name. I said, I'd like to be an asteroid. I've been rejected from some of the best universities in the United States. I was rejected from JPL a couple times and Rockefeller National. But I didn't say no. There's a quote that's attributed to Churchill that says, those who dare risk defeat, those who don't ensure it. Mm-hmm. So I tell people when they're looking for a job and getting out of work that just assume you're going to get 100 rejections. You want to go through that as fast as you can. It's like dating, they all can't say no. Okay? You want to find a one yes. Okay? So, you know the expression, fair weather friends? So it's friends that stick with you when things aren't well, but not when things are bad. You can extrapolate that to everything. You can do the quality of your relationship with your parents, with your professors, with your boss at work, with your dog. I mean,
when things are going well, that's easy. When things go wrong, that's a way to measure the caliber of you as a human being. So when you send a letter out and you get rejected, it's not like I'm going to go crawl into a hole and cry. It's, all right, now what am I going to do? That's how you are as a human being. And you shouldn't be looking for failures and you know, things that don't go your way. But those are opportunities for you as a human being to move yourself forward. Say, okay, now what am I going to do? And just find something you love. And what I did is I applied to different NASA centers. And I don't want to call every day and be obnoxious about it. But I look for ways of increasing my capability and how I'm going to be desirable to them. And every 6 months, try. And you just keep doing that. Because you just need it to hit once. All right. offering a fair amount. Go ahead.
So there was some talk about Mars colonization just before. I've seen a couple of articles and videos about possibly colonizing Venus.
Ooh, yeah. Sorry, I shouldn't do that kind of reaction. Go ahead.
Where they send like sort of sky cities and just hover around 50,000.
There is talk about doing it, yes.
Yeah, what are your thoughts, I guess?
Surface, Venus has a surface temperature of 900 degrees Fahrenheit. I don't know if that is in Celsius.
Too much.
It's pretty hot. It's 90 atmospheres of pressure, and if that isn't dumb enough, it has sulfuric acid rain. You can find a place higher in the atmosphere to float, but then I'm not sure what you'd be able to do on the surface. One of the ideas that I was toying with is, why don't you find the highest mountain peak on Venus, so that would be Mount Maxwell, and build your colony there. It's probably half as hot, the pressure's a lot less, and then you just kind of hike down into the muck, into the atmosphere as you go down. Except, you know, we're even trying wilder ideas. One of the questions people are curious about, is there volcanism and are there quakes on Venus? And one of the interesting ideas is, if you have a quake on Venus, since the atmosphere is thick, it would transmit a pressure wave through the atmosphere. And this transmission through the atmosphere would go all the way up, and as you got to Venus's ionosphere, those particles would also move in response to that quake. Well, moving charges give off their own signature. Could you do seismology by studying Venus's ionosphere? So maybe you don't have to go down it. Right now, that's just balloons, you could do it, but that'd be a very short lifetime, relatively speaking, and you still have the problem of looking through all that muck to try to get to the surface. So it depends on what you're trying to measure. Yeah.
Another thing I noticed you made no mention of was terraforming.
Yeah.
What are your thoughts? And is it too far off?
Terraforming, this is where you actually change the environment of a world to make it habitable. There are a number of ways to do it. You can do it on a small scale where you just do regions and domes, say, on Mars, and you just reclaim certain aspects of the planet as you get more and more of these domes and finally connect them up. Or you do it, you say, heck, I'm going to go for the whole enchilada and just try to do it all in one system. Doing that implies making the atmosphere thicker. Thicker atmosphere would actually retain more heat. That would melt more stuff, put more material up, and you can start doing a greenhouse effect. We're trying to heat up the place to make it habitable. I get nervous about doing things on a planetary scale. People want to do things on Earth on a planetary scale. I guess it's your bunny rabbits up in Australia. When you want to put, you know, iron filings in the ocean or things in the atmosphere, these are very, very complicated systems, and we have no idea how these systems work. So I think terraforming is a great idea, but the way we do space exploration, there are four steps. Phase one is your reconnaissance. You just go buy something to the basics. How big is it? What's it made of? How many moons? Does it have a magnetosphere? Phase two are temporal studies. You want to orbit something now for years of time. So rather than doing composition atmospheres, now you're doing weather and seasons. Phase three are your landers and sample returns. Phase four is human exploration. We're going on phase four on the moon. We're halfway through exploring this solar system. I believe you should only bring in, we call this the wetware, hardware, software, wetware. You should only do human exploration when it's economically viable. Because robotics is just a much more intelligent way to go. They're much more forgiving. You do a lot of these things. You don't have to name a high school after them if you lose them. But the bottom line is robotic expression is the way to go unless there's an economic reason for doing it. If there's an economic reason for doing it, then you're up to the races. Right now, there is no economic reason for sending people to other worlds yet. There's an emotional one, there's national pride, there's not an economic reason. There might be an economic reason for going back to the moon, but if you're not going to try to terraform the place, you better have a reason why you're trying to make that environment Earth-like, because the amount of energy and resource to do that will be phenomenal. Yeah?
Have we found aliens yet? Have we found the aliens? And what's Area 51?
Let me tell you a couple of alien stories. One, some researchers found a meteorite in Antarctica in the Allen Hills region in 1984. It was called ALH84001. First sample in 1984 at Allen Hills. Stayed in a drawer for about 10 years. People started exploring it and they realized that, holy cow, this is definitely Mars rock. We were able to prove that by the gases that were in it. And then they saw four things in it. They saw polyaromatic hydrocarbons, organics, carbonates, which you need a temperate environment for, you need iron oxides, which some bacteria poop out, and you had these microfossils. And they did Occam's razor. They said, I can either have four different processes all in a micro of each other, or just one life form. And in 1997, President Clinton announced that he thought that this could be life, and so there was money for us. That meteorite gave JPL $200 million every year, so every 26 months we could do another Mars mission. So think of this. A almost proof of life was worth $200 million a year to us. If we found life, an alien or anything, we couldn't keep it a secret, Area 51 or whatever, and we wouldn't want to. This would be just a great thing to do, and we'd love it. And I'm going to use one of the... Can I do another quick story real quick? I was going to drop something. Okay. This is my business cards. When I drop them, falls the distance S, where S equals 1/2 AT squared. It's the law. It's acceleration times time squared. Okay? I take this guy. What's your name?
Doug.
Doug? Yeah. I take him and I drop him off a cliff. He's going to fall the distance S equals 1/2 AT squared. He has to. It's part of the natural system. There's going to be some second order and third order terms because he's going to be flapping his arms and screaming. Light bulbs. When do light bulbs burn out? They burn out when you turn them on, not when they're on, maybe turn them off, definitely not when they're off. It's called a startup transient. In engineering, we call it infant mortality. Well, I would tell you, since we are a part of the natural system, we have to obey the same laws. I would tell you, people have startup transients. Being born, starting school, starting a job, starting a marriage, starting a family. Those are all startup transients. And then traumatic events. Some people can't tolerate going from one state to the next. Well, I would take that to the next level. I would tell you that humans are part of the same system. Humans should have startup transients. And I would tell you, this is kind of embarrassing, that we're warring, racist, polluting organisms. If you were a stable species, and you said, look what these guys are doing. You wouldn't come here. It would be like, ooh, I kidnapped grandma, or I cut circles in the thing. No. You'd come here with a Sagittarius bird, Carina Cygnus arm, Sol system, third rock, there's advanced mold. Let's come back here in a million years and see if they off themselves or do they stabilize out. Now, I'd like to believe we're going to be stable, but I think right now we're really pre-juvenile species. We argue about imaginary lines in the sand. We argue about melanin content. We argue about which major deity you care to believe in. I'm not sure how advanced we are. We're an advanced species. How do we make electricity? We boil water. Whether it's nuclear or fossil fuel, we burn water to make steam to do turbines. What's the runner-up technology? Paddles in a stream. Aren't we sophisticated? We are that far out of the cage. I can't believe aliens ever visited us. I'd like to believe, that's a good question. How many of you guys believe that we're alone in the universe? How many people think there's life out there? Oh, what a enlightened crowd. Yeah, that's right. There are a lot of people that think we're it. I have a tough time believing this is the best nature could do. So I'd love to find aliens.
We've never found any here. That's one of the big questions, why we haven't found them there. Area 51 did do research. It's not alien research. It just is. OK, I missed you last time. I'll get through it next. Go ahead.
Out of Enceladus and Europa,
yeah.
Which one do you find more promising for tech and life?
Out of Europa and Enceladus, which one do I find more promising? They're both equal in the sense that they both appear to have liquid water, and liquid water we think is the big thing to go for. We think, you know, early science fiction things that, you know, that how you know they're going to use water. Well, hydrogen is the most common element, helium is second, oxygen is third. So alcohols and water should be, everybody should be using this. Carbon makes much more sense than silicon, because it's right on the periodic table, but suns make much more carbon than silicon. Okay, so I just dropped my other track. Say that question again. That's all right, there you go. So we think it's going to be water-based. We think it's going to be life. The problem is you have to pick which child you like more. Europa is closer, but now you have to deal with the Jupiter's radiation. Enceladus doesn't have the radiation, but it's now a billion, you know, 1.6 billion kilometers downrange. We were looking at this mission called ELF for Enceladus Life Finder, where you want to go through the plume and see if you got something fun. There's three possible answers. No life, yes there's life, huh? If you get a huh and a life thing, then maybe you'd like to figure out how you could actually take that stuff and bring it home, because the research we can do here is much more sophisticated than spacecraft. Earlier this mission about bringing stuff back from the plumes, we're going, holy cow, that's an alien abduction. We're trying to take stuff out of the I think they're both compelling. Europa just seems to have so much water out there, and it's tough to believe how Enceladus stays wet and how much water is under the surface. So I've always been a fan of Europa. I just found this really, really tough. But it's a good choice to have. Yeah.
Thank you very much for the talk. I'm really fascinated by the ocean worlds that you were mentioning.
We all are.
Very strange and beautiful sort of idea. What kind of measurements do you use to actually be able to tell that there's no landmass? That's a very specific question, so for something a little more speculative, how long until JPL has an Art Deco poster of one that I can put on?
We do gravity field measurements. This is number one. And number two is we look at the magnetic field. So if we find that some of these moons that shouldn't have a molten core, so it's not circulating, it doesn't have a magnetosphere, we believe it's a circulating salt water that's generating these really weak magnetic signatures. We also do, when it comes to gravity fields, we do this thing where we have two spacecraft, you know, 150 kilometers apart, and if there's, this is crazy, man. As we're going overhead, these two spacecraft, the first one sees the mountain range, which is my business cards, so if one starts to accelerate, leave this one in the dust. And then after we pass that, it slows up and this one speeds up. So watching the spacecraft do this to a fraction of a micron, and not my hair because I don't have any, hairs are about 100 microns, so you're doing this to a fraction of a micron. We found that on the Earth, we can basically give the Earth an MRI. We can actually see what's going on underneath the surface. We can see Greenland rebounding because the ice is melting off. We can see hot and cold water bulges. We then did gravity field measurements out at the moon because we were trying to look for its core. We didn't find it, but we could actually see what's going on inside of the moon. I would love to take that gravity field stuff and go to Europa to see how thick the ice field is and to figure where the thin spots are, where I want to melt through. I'd love to go to take it to Mars and look for aquifers underneath the surface. We know that Titan's crust and its core don't rotate together, as if Titan is floating, its crust is floating on a liquid bearing. So there's a lot of fun places out there, but I don't know when you're going to get that poster. It's really fun. I mean, the way we do business is every 10 years, the Earth scientists, the solar system scientists, and the astrophysicists get together, not in the same year, and they do what's called the Decadal Report. And they say, in the next 10 years, this is the stuff we're going to do. These are questions. And NASA, we just try to do the ones on top of this list. And that's how we work. And when we're going to get to that stuff, we try to say we want missions that we can actually do in those 10 to 15 years. So don't give us something crazy. And for the most part, the scientists are well behaved. They do that. But I don't know when we're going to be able to do those missions. we're going to try to land on Europa first, maybe do some sounding, maybe some radar penetration of the ice field, see if we can do that in that environment. But it's not going to last long, you know, 6 months, maybe. It's just very difficult.
Excuse me, the SARS-REX mission you mentioned, it had was brief, but yeah. You showed it's bringing a big boulder back to put in orbit. I was reading today about it's going to take a long time to examine the asteroid Bennu and then go and put its probe down and get a smaller sample. So I'm not sure whether I was confusing.
Well, there's two different missions you're talking about. OSIRIS-REx is going to go to an asteroid Bennu and get a piece and come back.
A small piece.
Right. And then there's the asteroid redirect mission that's going to orbit an asteroid, pick up a boulder off, and put that around the moon.
Yeah.
So OSIRIS-REx is going to go back to Earth, and this one's going to go back to the moon.
Okay, sorry.
That's okay. And this side. These are the guys who are asking questions. Yeah.
That's on that bringing stuff back to Earth. But asteroid mining, how do you get the mine stuff back to Earth?
The question is, when it comes to asteroid mining, how do you get the material back to Earth? That's a good question. I also don't know a business plan how they're going to actually do this successfully, because in order to do the mining, that presupposes you're getting the price per pound up and down pretty cheap. And if it's pretty cheap, then I don't know if you need really to go out to an asteroid to mine it. You know, I think people might have a problem mining the moon. I mean, can you strip mine the moon? Would an environmentalist be upset? I don't know. You're not making it uninhabitable. It already is uninhabitable. So I don't know how that works. For the life of me, I can't figure out what their business model is. But things can change, you know. People can say, well, why would you go up in space? And you've got a lot of multi-billion dollar industries. Yeah?
Going back to the Institute of Resource stuff, like, so what's the sort of time frame for the mission? Say, like, when it lands, how long does it take to build up enough fuel to be able to come back to Earth?
The question is when it comes to ISRU, the In-Situ Resource Utilization, where you actually use material on that world to make a fuel and an oxidizer come back, we haven't done that yet. So the best we're doing is just seeing how we can make oxygen out of this place. You'd like to be relatively efficient with this thing. For all we know, you may actually put a in-situ resource utilization plant on the surface that you land nearby, and it's been doing this all the time before you get there, and it makes supplies for you. One of the business cases that Dr. Spoutis, he's a scientist over in the US, he thinks in-situ resource utilization is the way to go and actually make a business case for the moon, would be to go in a permanently shadowed crater, take out the water that's supposedly in the shadowed regions, make hydrogen and oxygen liquefied, and then put that to these fueling depots. So now when you launch off the Earth, after the first stage lands, that's Elon Musk, you take your second stage and you don't drop it, you drag that to this floating gas station and you refill your second stage, so now you have a big engine outside the gravity well for going faster to places. But right now I don't have good time for how long it takes to do that. It really depends on how much capability you have on the surface.
I'd like to go for one more question.
There you go. Okay.
Do you think we'll be looking at space elevators within our lifetimes? Or is it a possible?
The question, are we looking at space elevators in our lifetime? First of all, I want to give you a definition that I like to use. It's the definition of the word impossible. No, this is a real working definition, and it'll be really useful. The definition of impossible is that which violates a natural law. So, can you go faster than the speed of light? No, that's impossible. Can human beings live to be 400 years old? If you can't point to the law it violates, it just means we don't know how to do it. Now, when it comes to space elevators, the material you need for those cables for this elevator right up and down is? It's in the unobtainium world. So I would tell you that's impossible. I, right now, can't tell you what it violates, but right now I know we have nothing that has material strength to be able to do that. Not to mention all the other problems. You know, when you have a conductor moving through a magnetosphere, you generate current. We lost tethers on the space shuttle, which we took this tether out, which had a cable, and as it was moving through in orbit, it generates so much current, you just fry this cable and just throw it off of it. So there are a lot of issues other than the tensile strength to do this stuff. And as the price per pound falls down, you may not need a space elevator. So I would say the price per pound on rockets is going to go a lot sooner than the space elevator. All right, I'm going to stay up here later on, but thank you very much.
like to invite Maurice Timpson, Chairman of the Aeronautical Society of Melbourne, Maurice, to give a vote of thanks.
Thank you. And, well, I'd like Randii's day job. Hands up those who like Randii's day job. Randii's given us the permission to dream and to do anything, right? Because it's what he's shown, I think, is that it's about how you integrate that knowledge because you're passionate about what it means. So I think that's been an enormous privilege for us here this evening. And the Royal Aeronautical Society is absolutely extremely proud to join with the AIAA and the Space Association of Australia to thank Randii for an absolutely outstanding talk. I can see that everybody here is absolutely enthralled. So without further ado, I'm going to present to you a small memento from the Royal Aeronautical Society and a lovely book about Melbourne and its regions. So we had a great day. We had a great day today at Healesville Sanctuary. So he's got up close with our wildlife, or a little bit of it. And it was a great day. It was really fun. So please join with me in thanking Randii. Thanks, everybody. That concludes this evening's. Come and ask Randii. He might have a sticker.